mercy seat of God was also a human being. And when God is walking, God walks in dispensation. Understand? When it was mercy seat, it was a type of mercy. That means it was in the seven church ages. Okay? Seven church ages, yeah? Are you with me?
Yes.
This one was the mercy seat. Okay. In there you have seven messengers. Okay?
Yes.
Seven messengers. All of them. Seven stars. The first one was the second. Next. And. Okay. So according to the Bible, these seven messengers here, okay, they were God's seat. Okay. And it wasn't the seat of judgment. Why? Because in that time, God didn't come yet as a judge. Are you with me?
Yeah.
God came as a priest. Okay? The same Jesus in seven colors in the seven church ages, and this one was called the mercy seat, the dispensation of mercy. You understand? Why? Because God was calling people from each age, church age. Right? Jesus was a priest, not a judge. Okay? He was a priest. Okay? In the mercy seat. As I said, the seat is human. Okay? Are you with me? But this one is Jesus. Do you understand?
Yes.
Jesus came himself in those seven messengers. From Paul came to preach, and Paul was Jesus for this age. Paul went there. When Paul left, the message, now Jesus went to Emmaus. When Paul left, they didn't walk at the same time, all of them. One will live and one will come. Okay? God manifesting himself in seven different ways, seven times, for the seven church ages. What God was doing, he was giving a message to his people to redeem them. And it was a time of mercy. So these people here, all their heart, okay, was the seat of God. So Paul was the mercy seat in the age of Ephesus. Is it easy? Yeah. So and so, the second one, the same. Until the seventh messenger, which was Barabbas also, was a mercy seat for the people. But another thing is, you must be careful with Barabbas, because Barabbas after this one, he was a messenger, okay? Are you with me?
Yes.
But he was also a prophet. It's not the same. Do you know that? All the seven messengers wasn't prophets. They were only messengers. Okay? Except Paul was a prophet as well. Barabbas said. And the last prophet also must be a prophet. Because he had a double job. He would do his job first as a messenger, okay? And then he do up the job of the prophet. What is the prophet is? The prophet is the son of man. Is it hard? Okay? Is it okay? It's okay. So I want you to know these things. You understand? Because it's going to be easy for you to understand what you are preaching. Right? And then, he told, the Bible said that God called Jeremiah the son of man. The son of man means the prophet. That is the reason Jesus is the son of man. He was also a prophet. Those seven messengers wasn't prophet. Those five messengers wasn't prophets, except Paul and Barabbas. The reason why Barabbas was a prophet, because Barabbas was had also the job of the judge. Are you with me?
Yeah.
He was also a judge. Now, after these seven messengers, you see now when the cloud came down, Barabbas said that he is the supreme judge. Do you understand? That means the throne of God or the seat is not the seat of mercy anymore. It becomes now the seat of judgment. Because after seven church ages, the mercy is over. You understand? Now he becomes a judge. Now, God said he's not a messenger, a priest anymore. He is now a judge. That's the reason he came down with the white wig. The white wig means a judge. If you see, you go to the court here in the UK, you see the judge has got the white wig. You understand? So, because God always is looking for the heart of the people, when he came as a priest through the seven church ages, he got the heart of the seven messengers. One messenger for each age. Amen. When he comes again as a judge, he needs a heart. When the Bible is talking about the throne of God is always a human heart. For this one was human heart, but in this last day, he must take one person again. But God, Jesus, had only seven stars. Okay, the last star was Barabbas, and he had to finish all the work. Do you understand? That's the reason I'm preaching the present stage of my ministry. Okay? So Barabbas had different ministry. He was a messenger and then he was also a prophet. Now Barabbas was doing the job of the Son of Man, which was to discern the thoughts of the heart of the people. If you notice, all of them, they didn't do it. Only Barabbas done it. Because Barabbas was the throne of Jesus in this age.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Amen.
And then when Jesus became a judge, the same Jesus, when he changed his position, he became a judge. He took the heart of this man here, William Branham, to judge the earth. That is the reason you saw Barabbas. His life first must be an example before to preach others or before to judge others. Are you with me? That's the reason I read this one. Knowing that your bodies are members of Christ. Amen. God created you for his glory. And in each age, God has got a job for everyone. Now, because we are living now over the seven church ages, Jesus is not a priest anymore, but Jesus is a judge. Because his throne is the human heart, God will take your heart to judge the world.
Amen.
The Bible says, knowing not that you sense, you judge hell. You understand? Mm. How do you judge yourself? By showing, reflecting Christ in your life. Because if you have a judge, you go to the court, you see a judge which is a thief. Do you think that person is allowed to be a judge? No. It's not because he's afraid of it, but it's because he's doing that job. He knows that as a judge, I must have an example life. Amen. Amen. So if you're a judge, you must be clean yourself. Amen. Amen. Because you can't tell me to stop smoking, as I said last time, when you're smoking yourself. So, but I heard you smoking a cigarette. He said, I see someone smoke. He said, why do you smoke? Smoking is bad. Stop smoking. It's not good. Do you understand?
Yes.
Do you think that person is going to listen to me?
No.
What is he going to say? You are smoking yourself. So if I want to tell someone to stop smoking, if I'm a smoker, the first thing to do is to stop smoking first. Then the person will listen to me. So you can't be a judge if you are not living a clean life. No, it doesn't make sense. So I want you to notice that you are the thought of God and God is reflecting himself to you. Last time I was trying to show you only what is the seat of God or the throne of God. So I've been showing you with Barabbas that the seat of God is not a chair but is your heart. As Barabbas said, I'm going to read again, said, God's throne is in the human heart. There we become one. One in purpose, one in achievement. So even the oneness between we and God, Barabbas said, we are not one like my finger. Amen. He said, we are the throne of God. Then we become one with God. How? He said, one in purpose and one in achievement. So we are working together with God. That's the oneness. Amen. That's the meaning of the oneness. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. What? Knowing not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you. So, what is the Holy Ghost? In a message by one of which he called the Holy Ghost, he said, what is the Holy Ghost? He said, the Holy Ghost is the person of God. Amen. So when the Holy Ghost comes in you, I don't mean the gift of the Holy Ghost is something else than the Holy Ghost itself. Amen.
Amen.
So my gift, I can't give you this one. Oh, I can't give you my phone. I said, this is my gift to you. Do you understand? It's the gift from Brother Eric, but it's not Brother Eric. Do you understand?
Yeah.
The gift of the Holy Ghost is the healing, speaking tongues. Amen. But still not Jesus. You can have it, have them, but you still don't have Jesus. But when I say that, so many people when they got gifts, they thought they had Jesus. Amen. The Holy Ghost is the person of Christ himself, living in a human being. That's the reason the Bible says, knowing not your body is the temple. Because God wants to dwell in you, God wants to reflect himself in you, God wants to show himself to the people through you.
Amen.
Amen. That's the very reason God created you. God didn't create you to go and walk, play games. God created you for his own glory. As I said last time, if I spend my money to buy a car, I want that car to serve me. Amen? I want the car to take me to work. I want the car to take me to church. So the car is going to do what I'm going to ask the car to do. So if the car starts doing something else, there's no point to use that car. Amen.
Amen.
Like what a person, the car is not working, what a person is going to do? What a person is going to spend money to repair the car. You understand? So it's his pocket money, he's going to use it to repair the car. Amen. And that car must do what a person wants the car to do. So if you are sick, God is going to heal you. But the thing is, why God is going to heal you for? God wants to heal you for you to reflect him. Amen. But I want to say that if we don't understand why we are here, then we are wasting our time. If you go to school, you don't understand why you are there, you are wasting your time. You go to school to succeed in your life. Don't go to school and do something else. No, you are wasting your time. The main reason why you are going to school is to study. To know more about science, about mathematics, whatever. And to succeed to the end of it. Exam is not the reason why you're going to school. No. The reason they are giving you the exam is to test if you understood the lessons. But the very reason you're going to school is to learn. You are not going to school for the exams. Do you understand? So many people today, they go to school, they are preparing themselves just to pass the exam. No, that's not the main point. The main point is to understand.
Amen.
Amen. People today in the churches, they come to God because they want to go to the rapture. No. That's not what God is expecting you to do. God wants you to know exactly who you are.
Amen.
The reason we are teaching this one is to show you your true identity. To tell you that this human body standing here is not you. The true you is the Holy Ghost inside of you. That's what we're doing here. That's the reason today, so many people, they can't manage Christian life anymore. Become hard now. Become a burden. Do you understand? Even school now become a burden for other people. Some of them say, oh, I'll stop going to school. I'll do something else. Because they don't really understand why they are going there. Amen. Even myself, when I'm preaching here, if I don't understand why I'm preaching, I'm wasting my time. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Why I'm preaching? I'm preaching because I've got something God told me to tell you. If I don't have anything to say, I'm not going to stand here and speak to you. Amen. Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God. So you got that Holy Ghost from God. Because you are part of God, God created you in his own image. Amen.
Amen.
And the image of God is not your body. The image of God is your theophany,
Amen.
Which is in you, the spiritual man.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
And you are not your own. You don't belong to yourself. You belong to someone. Amen.
Amen.
So your body is the temple. The Bible says that your body is the temple. The Bible doesn't say that your body is you. No. Your body is the temple. And the temple is not you. But when I said that, the reason I say my hand, my head, in the same way I can say my shoes is not me, my hand is not me, my head is not me. But I want to say, who am I? Amen. I am the one who was created in the image of God. And that person in the image of God, it is the mercy seat of God. And this body is only the temple. Do you understand? If you build your temple for the service of the Lord, if people come doing something else under the temple, that's become bad. The temple is, if we get money, God bless us. We get money, millions of pounds, we build our own church. We keep our instrument there, we don't have to take them off anymore. Then the purpose of that building is going to be to praise the Lord. So when we come in the building, start doing something else, will be very bad, isn't it?
Yeah.
So as a temple, the purpose of it is that God wants to dwell in you. God wants to reflect himself through you.
Yeah.
That's the very reason. Praise God. And then if you understand that, then you'll be judges. You'll be judging according to the law of contrast. Do you know contrast? You know what contrast means? Contrast is the difference. If there's no evil, you never know the good. If you're not hungry, you never know that you have to eat. If you don't fall sick, you never know the healing. Do you understand? You never appreciate good health. So when you know some people, they are just complaining. Oh, God didn't do anything for me. God didn't. But when he's standing there, healthy, strong, I'm telling you, it's a gift. You go to the hospital, you see so many people laying on the bed, they can't move their feet. Amen.
Amen.
Good health is the first gift God gives to you. How many people know about it? The law of contrast is to appreciate something. Before to appreciate the good health, you must fall sick first. When you see people on the street walking, you say, oh, I want to be like them. Then you'll be looking for the healing. Do you understand? The law of contrast. Now, the judge, you judge according to the law of contrast. You live a clean life, then people will see God in you. And when you're talking things of God. People will feel bad and say, oh, why I'm not like you? Myself, when I came in the message, it was for the testimony of a brother. That brother never preached the message. He was my friend. I was going to his house. The way he was living, I said, I want to be like you. Do you understand? And then he told me that I believe the message, but I got a message. He said, everything you see in me is coming from this message. Then I said, oh, wow, I want to become like you. Then I believe the message. He didn't tell me about Varagona. I saw his life. But when I said, I don't preach me two sermons, he said, leave me one. It's making more sense. Amen? The Bible says, which you have of God and you are not your own. You don't belong to yourself. Amen? For you are both with a price, therefore glorify God in your body. Glorifying God is not saying prayers. Yes, praise God. That's not glorifying God. Glorifying God will glorify God with you. In your body and in your spirits, which are
God's.
They belong to God. They don't belong to you. If you want to understand that this body doesn't belong to you, then today you are going to fall sick. Amen. You need the healing. You understand that all this body is not mine. I need the maker to come and help me. Amen. Praise God. My mom said this in a message, speak to the rock and it shall give forth his water. He said, but then come to a place called Calvary. No, I'll jump this one. And judgment begins at the house of God. The judgment begins at the house of God. First of all, you need to judge yourself. Amen. But I say that a small voice speaking to you. As that man, he took gold. Yeah, but I say that he had gold. He said, in the morning I'm going to sell it and I'll become a rich man. He said, oh, let me sleep. He said, then the dog was barking outside all night. He said, you are troubling me. I'm gonna become a rich man in the morning. So you stop making noise. I want to sleep. The dog still barking, and then he took his gun, he killed the dog. But obviously, it's the same way with the people. When they are doing that, they hear the small voice coming from inside of their heart, and they'll kill it, they'll ignore it, and then they'll become like that man. So in the morning, someone came in the house and killed the man. So his dream went off. I mean, his dream ended. You understand? So that small voice is the judgment, because you are the judgment thought of God, the judgment seat. So you've got the judgment in you first. Amen. Amen. But I know, can you check this camera? Take care of it. So you become yourself a judgment seat. So the voice we speak in you is going to clean you first. God, if God chose you to be a judge, he's going to clean you first before to present you as a judge. Amen. Amen. See, it is where the judgment begins. I don't see why so many complain that I speak too hard to the people. You know that. But I used to tell people what to do. I used to tell them stop doing this and that. But I said that his is to begin at the right hand where justice and righteous and judgment of God is to go forth from the pulpit from here. Even myself, I'm concerned. I must be judged. Amen. I must have an example life before to be a judge. Right? So the judgment begins on the pulpit. And First Peter chapter 4:17. For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it is first begin at us, what shall the end of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well doing as unto faithful creatures. Amen. I'll read this one before to close. But I believe that the three Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is one. That they are three offices of one God. He lives in the fatherhood, in the pillar of fire. He lives in the sonship in Jesus Christ. And he lives now in the Holy Ghost, in his church. That means you and me. Okay. The same Lord Jesus that was made flesh and dwelt among us is with us this day among us in the form of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, as I said, is the person of God living now in the church. The church is you and me. So you become now the judgment seat of God, as we are not living in the seven church ages anymore. Are you with me? Amen. Message of grace. So it was but Abraham first, then he brought the message unto us, then we became the message. And the message is nothing else than the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Amen. Closing. But Abraham said this. He said, you might not think that people are watching you. As I said last time, yeah. Your neighbors, your friends in school, they know that you are believers, Christians. But they are watching every move you make. Are you with me?
Yes.
You are a Bible to many people. Yeah. You are a Bible to many people. So this Bible will become effective, or this Bible is going to become real if you become it. Okay? I like this one. You are a Bible to many people. Therefore, we got to watch what we do. Our business deals and everything that we do in our entire work. Amen. I'm not doing it because I'm afraid of hell. No. I'm doing it because I'm an example. I am a judge. Before to judge people, I must judge myself, because the judgment begins in the house of God. Amen? He said, what I'm saying is saying that just yield yourself to the Spirit and God will reflect himself through you. Amen. So God wants to reflect himself through you. The only way to make God real to the people is you to take God in you, to reflect him. So that means that your life is not the same as those people. Your life must be different. Amen. Let them to see something different they never seen before. Say, oh, why you are so different? Why the way you are dressing? Why the way you talk is different? Why? Then you say that I believe the message. Then in that time, God is reflecting himself for you. Amen. As I said, like a vine, Jesus said in John 15, I am the vine, ye are what? The branches. Jesus is the vine, and you are the branches. And this vine is the tree. Okay? The tree is made with branches, but everything is making the tree. And Jesus is the tree, and we are branches. That means that we are attached to him. The branch is not the tree. Amen. The branch is the part of the tree, but all together is making the tree. So Jesus is not Jesus without you and me. We all attached to Jesus, we make Jesus. Is it clear? We all attached to Jesus, then we make Jesus. So if you are the branch, that means you must be attached to Jesus. If you take that branch off of the tree, what is going to happen? It's going to die. So that's the reason, above as a branch, you must be connected to the tree, which is Jesus. And Jesus is the Word.
Amen.
So if you get yourself out of the Word, you dry out and you die. And you never bear the fruit anymore. Before the branch will give fruit, the branch must be attached to the tree. And the tree is Jesus, and you and me, we are branches.
Amen.
Is it clear?
Yes,
Sister Priscilla. Good. Amen. I am the vine, you are the branches. Well, now remember, the vine does not bear the fruit. So Jesus doesn't need to bear the fruit. You have to bear the fruit. You have to show to the people that you are Christian. Do you understand? Because you are branches. Jesus is not branches, the tree. So if you want to see the fruit, you see it on the branches. That means you and me.
Yeah.
Is it clear? It's the branch that bears fruit, but it gets its life from the vine. Because the life of the branches are coming, the life of the branches is coming from the tree. That means even the branches produce the fruit. That means the fruit is coming from the tree. Do you understand? So there's communication. So the tree will never say, okay, I don't want you anymore. Because without the branch, there's no fruit. The tree wants to produce the fruit. Jesus wants to produce the fruit, but for you. Do you understand? He wants to reflect himself through you, that you produce the fruit. Otherwise, Jesus is not going to produce anything. And the branch also cannot say, I don't need the tree, because if you get yourself out of the tree, there's no fruit. So both must be together. That's the reason God wants you to be in connection with him permanently. Amen?
Amen.
For you to reflect him. God is not a human being. God is spirit.
Amen.
The only way God to make himself visible to the people is to come through you. That the reason said you must live a clean life. Amen.
Amen.
That the way the saints will judge this earth. But when you say that, every unbeliever will appear before the person that preached him the message. You understand? So every believer is a judge. God doesn't have a time, doesn't have time to sit down and judge him one by one. No. God gives you the responsibility to do it. You do it through your life, Brother Dennis. You tired? He's fighting with you. If you sleep, God, he's going like this. You don't sleep early, that's the reason. Go early to bed, then you'll be strong in the morning. Yeah? Yes, Brother Ron.
Amen.
So, you are the vine, you are the branches, and Jesus is the vine. So, you are, the vine is The branch is the vine also. Do you understand? That's the reason if we are part of Christ, that means we are Christ. Amen. You can be a branch, but the branch is also the tree. If you are part of Jesus, a son of God, that means you are God. Because you are God. Anyway. You see. Let me draw something here. So this is the tree, okay? Okay. And this tree has got the branches. Do you understand? Branches everywhere. Okay. Is Jesus. Okay? The tree. Okay. And this is the branch. Okay? Which is you. You understand? Mm-hmm. And this tree is Jesus, and those branches are you and me. And we are part of the tree. That's the way we are one with Jesus. You understand? So if you cut this one, okay, you cut this branch, okay, do you think the tree is going to die? No, the tree is going to produce another branch. But this branch will die. So that means that if you get yourself out of Christ, you are dying. But Christ is not dying. Do you understand? So the branch is not planted on the ground. The branch is planted on the tree. But the tree is planted on the ground. So the life is coming from the ground, okay? Giving life to the tree. And the tree is giving life to the branches. Are you familiar?
Yes.
It is the same. That's the reason why Abraham said that we are one with Christ. But we are not one like my finger. And we are not two. You understand? You can't be two. Those branches with Christ, they can't be two. They are one. It's one tree. You understand? It's like your body is made with fingers, head, legs, everything. That's you. But Eric is my hair, even my nails. Amen. When you call it Brother Eric, even my nails, you call it Brother Eric. So if I take them off, is my nail Brother Eric anymore? Yeah. No, it's my nail. Brother Eric is still here. I'll produce another one. You understand? But as long as they are attached there, we are one. We are one with God in that way. You understand? That's the reason Brother Branham said that the bread and Christ, they are one. So that's the reason you are God in human form. God in this earth. Through you, God wants to talk to the people. Through you, God wants to judge. And you are the mercy seat. The judgment seat of God. The judgment throne of God. It's what we call white throne. Now, most of the people, when they hear about the white throne, they think that there's going to be a big chair, a white chair, where God is going to sit. He's going to sit there, and people will come for the judgment. You see? This is the image people have for the judgment, the seat of judgment, the throne of judgment, the white throne. It's not like that. Do you understand? You forget about this one. It is God judging people in the heart of people. Do you understand? Jesus said, one day he said, get out of me. I never know you. He said, when was it? He said, I came to you. I was sick. You didn't give me medicine. I was hungry. You didn't give me food. He said, when was it? He said, you didn't do it to one of the little ones of my kingdom. You done it to me. He said, because Jesus was in those little ones. Do you understand? It's like Paul, when he went to persecute Christians, said, Paul, why thou persecuted me? He said, who are you? He said, I am Jesus. So Jesus became the disciples. Do you understand? When Jesus came back in the upper room, he became Peter, he became Matthew, and all of them. Do you understand? And today, Jesus is nothing else than you and me. So if Jesus comes today as a judge, he will come as a judge through you and me. So it's our responsibility to judge. Do you understand? Is it clear? Amen?
Amen.
So from now, you forget about this one, okay? Forget about this one. I'm trying to clean your mind. Amen.
Amen.
You see, most of the people, amen, they believe this. But when Abraham came, he said, it's not this one, forget.
Amen.
Amen. It's not that one. Amen. God bless you.